After all these considerations and understanding of self-adjoint operators, we should now really maybe make the contact with physics. So I mean, this whole theory, in particular, also this unbounded operator and self-adjoint operators, and this was developed by von Neumann, mainly or with the intention of providing a mathematical rigorous theory for the description of quantum mechanics. And maybe now we really should, now we are at a point where we can maybe say how the physics relates to the mathematics. And so that's what I want to do here. So I want to give you somehow the axiomatic description of quantum mechanics according to von Neumann. This is the standard description, the axiomatic of quantum mechanics. So how do we describe quantum mechanical system, and what does it mean to measure something there? So first of all, quantum mechanical system. So this is described by Hilbert spaces. So all the action happens on the Hilbert space. So in principle, if I have a system, this corresponds somehow to a Hilbert space, and then I have to say what corresponds to things I'm doing with my system, or describing the system, the physical system, in terms of what am I doing in the Hilbert space. So first of all, so let's say a quantum mechanical system corresponds to a Hilbert space, and of course, I mean, Hilbert spaces are always complex in our setting, but maybe let me say it explicitly here again, because it's really, to be complex is really important. So I mean, of course, in nature, usually you are only measuring real numbers, so it might not be clear that you need complex numbers, but in the quantum mechanical context, it's really complex numbers are really going down to the core of the thing. So it corresponds to complex, and then okay, we should also be separable, a Hilbert space, as we always assumed our Hilbert spaces to be separable, but I think it's hard to imagine in nature something which is not really separable. Yeah, and then of course, so we have a system, and now the system is somehow in a given state, so it is prepared somehow. And so how do we describe now the system? And this is described by a unit vector in my Hilbert space. So this is the state of my system, and actually this is a pure state. This means I have absolute knowledge about my system. So I mean, of course, in classical mechanics, you have the deterministic description, so you know exactly in which state your system is, and you can measure and calculate everything. And then, of course, there is the statistical component of statistical mechanics, also that you don't know exactly in which state the system is. So in statistical mechanics, you say you only have a probability distribution about the possible states, and you don't know exactly in which state you are, so you make a probabilistic description. And I mean, in quantum mechanics, you can do the same. So you have a description where you know everything, as much as you can, about the system, and that's what I'm calling a pure state. But then there's also an extension of this, where you don't know exactly in which state the system is, but again you make a statistical description that you get a superposition, a probability distributions for possible states. Okay, and this is something which goes a little bit further, and which I could also describe, but I don't want to do this. So what I really want to describe here is a pure state, which means you have absolute knowledge about the system. So this in classical mechanics, this means there is no probability around, because you know everything exactly. And that's the pure states which we have here, and those are described mathematically by states, by vectors in my Hilbert space. So this corresponds to a unit vector, a vector of norm 1, so unit vector x in my Hilbert space. Unit vector means that the norm of this guy is equal to 1. And actually it turns out that I can multiply my vector with a phase, a complex number of absolute value 1, and I have the same, this describes the same physical reality. So multiplying everything by such a thing is the same, corresponds to the same system. So maybe let me also write this down. So this means in particular, everything which I'm going to say, how you calculate things for a given system, I mean, if you change x to alpha x, then this shouldn't make a difference. So actually, alpha x for alpha complex number with absolute value 1 describes the same state. Yeah, as x. Yeah, okay, so those are the pure states where you know exactly how your system is prepared, and you know everything about your system. Good, now you have your system, and now you want to make measurements. Okay, and measurements, so or observables, let's say. Observables are things which you want to measure. So maybe you want to measure the position of something, you want to measure the momentum of something, and those measurements actually correspond to self-adjoint operators on your Hilbert space. So let's say the observables, that are the quantities which you want to measure, or what you can measure. So each observable corresponds to a self-adjoint operator. And of course, I mean, that's, if you want to know, I mean, which measurement corresponds concretely to which self-adjoint operator, I mean, then you have to go to the physics department and ask those people. I mean, they know how to do this. So this here is just a very abstract, general setting. So observables correspond to self-adjoint operators. Operators on H, but in general they can be unbounded, and then that's why we talked about the unbounded operators. But self-adjoint is important, and it's self-adjoint, not just symmetric. Okay, and so why is self-adjoint important? Because then we have the spectral theorem. So we really, with the self-adjoint operators comes this spectral decomposition, which means in particular we also have all the characteristic function of this operator. For symmetric operators, we don't have this. The spectral theorem is really for self-adjoint operators, not for symmetric ones. So, now we really want to see what does it mean to measure now something, to make a measurement of an observable, let's say an observable corresponding to a given self-adjoint operator, and our system is in a state which corresponds to a vector in a Hilbert space. And so what can we then say about the measurement? So the measurement of an observable, and let's say this corresponds to an operator, a self-adjoint operator, let me call it T, corresponding to T. So now I'm fixing my system, which is prepared somehow. So this is described by a vector in my Hilbert space. And I'm choosing a measurement which I want to make. So this corresponds to a concrete self-adjoint operator. Let us call this T. And this T, via the spectral theorem, comes with a resolution of the identity. So I can write it as lambda dE lambda. And I have all those projection valued guys. So this means I have essentially all the characteristic functions of T, and much more functions, but in particular the characteristic ones. Okay, so I want to do a measurement of an observable corresponding to this self-adjoint operator, and I want to measure this on a system which is described by a unit vector x in my Hilbert space, so corresponding x in my Hilbert space. Yeah, okay, and now comes the surprise of quantum mechanics, that even though I have absolute knowledge over my system, which is described by the vector x, and I make a measurement, the outcome of the measurement is not uniquely determined. But there are possible outcomes in general, and I only have a probability distribution for the outcome. I mean, in classical mechanics, that is not what is going to happen. If you have absolute knowledge about your system, then you make and you make a measurement, then you measure exactly the value which is given by your prescription of the system. Okay, but in quantum mechanics, this is not true. So even if you have as much knowledge as is possible over the system, for general measurements, the outcome will not be determined by this, but it will only be a probability distribution. And this probability distribution, this is something which we can calculate from the data which we have here. Okay, so let's see. So on a system corresponding to this, so this measurement has as possible outcomes, okay, values, yeah, real values, and the values are now related, or they are, the possible values are exactly the elements in the spectrum of your operator. So has as possible outcomes values lambda in the spectrum of our operator T. We want to measure the operator T, and the spectrum of T are the possible values which we can measure. Yeah, but we are not measuring those with certainty, but usually we only have a probability distribution. So with probability distribution, which is given, yeah, by taking our spectral measure for the operator and take the inner product of this with our vector x. So we have an operator and we have vectors, so the canonical thing of pairing those guys is taking the inner product x t x, but we're doing this for this e here. So what we have is actually the measure which is given by d x comma e lambda x. So this here is our distribution function. This is now a real value distribution function which we can use for Lebesgue-Sylvius integration, or this is the probability from, so this function here is the probability from minus infinity to lambda. So maybe let me write it more concretely like this. So the probability of measuring a value lambda in the interval from minus infinity to lambda zero, this is exactly this quantity here, the inner product between x, e lambda zero, x. And e lambda zero is this resolution of the identity, which you remember. I mean, you should think of this as being a quantity which corresponds to the interval from minus infinity to lambda zero. So this goes with this. Or maybe we can just take the E of B's for Borel sets, and then it really gives me the probability measure. So, or for any Borel set B in R, so for any measurable set, for example intervals or whatever, we can also say what is the probability that lambda is in B, that I measure a result which lies in a set B. This is given by taking the inner product between X and EBX, where the EBs are now this projection valued elements from the spectral resolution, or integrating the characteristic function of the set B with respect to my spectral resolution. Yeah, okay, and maybe we can also, so this is the general prescription or axiomatic, and I mean this is if you're used to classical mechanics, this is strange because you only measure probabilities. And I mean, from the beginnings of quantum mechanics, there was a big debate whether this makes sense or whether there should not be more in the background, hidden variables or whatever. But I mean, it turns out this is the description, and yeah, probably there is not much more to say. So it really, you can only calculate probabilities, and we have a very precise, very precise dictum which tells us how we calculate probabilities. Good, and maybe we should also put the spectral theorem or the functional calculus. If I have t, I can of course take f of lambda here, which gives me an f of t here. So this means I can take functions of myself, adjoint operator, and of course this corresponds then to making measurements where I'm taking the function of my value. So if I'm, I mean, on the physical side, this is of course clear. If I measure some quantities, I can of course take functions of these measurements, and then I'm measuring the function of the original thing. And in this setting here, of course, this corresponds to measuring the function of my operator. So this is maybe clear, but it fits together. So in the setting of 4, so what I had here before, I have operator t and I have a vector x, and for a measurable function, f, which, as we have seen before, doesn't have to be defined on all of R, but actually only on the spectrum of R, or a spectrum of my operator. And let's say I want again a self-adjoint operator, so I should take a real-valued function. So then, for such a situation, then I can take the self-adjoint operator f of t, and of course this corresponds then to taking the function of my observable, so the function f of the observable. So this means I measure something, but then I apply a function to the outcome of my measurements, which should be just a measurement of the function of this. So I mean, in physical terms, it's absolutely clear that I should be able not only measure my observable, but any function of them. But if I make this connection that I say an observable corresponds to a self-adjoint operator, this means I must also have a theory which allows me to take all functions of my operator. And that's exactly what the functional calculus does. But it really, I mean, on the mathematical side, this functional calculus is a very heavy machinery. So this is something which we need to make this correspondence to the physics. But mathematically, this is really, this is not obvious that this can be done. And it can be done for self-adjoint operators. And again, this shows that self-adjoint is really the right setting. Okay, and so maybe let me also make a few remarks in this setting. So namely, maybe again, think about the difference between point spectrum and continuous spectrum. What does it mean for this measurement? So I mean, the spectrum of a self-adjoint operator can be decomposed into two parts. There is the point spectrum, and then the rest is the continuous spectrum. Residual spectrum is not there for self-adjoint operators. So either we have eigenvalues with eigenvectors, or we are in a continuous setting where we don't have eigenvectors, but we have at least those approximate eigenvectors. And of course, they also have a interpretation in this measurement language. So, but first of all, first let us look on the point spectrum, maybe because that's maybe the clearer part. So if lambda is in the point spectrum, then of course then lambda is an eigenvalue and I have corresponding eigenvectors, and of course the projection onto this is given by my E applied to the set lambda. Or to put it, I mean, in the language of having the E lambdas as a function, this I really have a jump at lambda. Okay, and this jump corresponds to a projection onto the eigenspace. Now in this language, this is just E of the point lambda. So this is not zero. This is not zero. So if I don't have a jump, then this is zero, and nothing really happens. This is like in a classical case. So if I have jumps, this corresponds to really that I have atoms there, and otherwise I have continuous parts where there is no jump, and if I want to project exactly onto this value, I just get zero. So okay, but let us first look where I have exactly such eigenvectors. Then this guy here is the projection on two vectors which actually are eigenvalues, and this for the measurement means that they give the value lambda, with probability 1. Yeah, because then, so if I look on this quantity here, and I'm choosing now the x such that I'm in the eigenspace for e, for this e lambda, then this means this guy here is just 1. So this quantity here is then just 0, and it jumps to 1 at the position lambda. So this means I can prepare my system in a state that I'm actually sure that the outcome of a measurement is exactly 1 value. So I get just the delta peak at 1. But this is only possible if I'm really in a point spectrum. Because then I really have eigenvectors for this lambda, and if my system is in such an eigenstate, then the measurement will exactly give lambda. So then I really have a deterministic situation. But typically I have continuous spectrum, and then this quantity is 0, there are no eigenvectors, this means I cannot prepare my system, there is no vector in my Hilbert space, so there is no possibility for preparing my system, such that with probability 1, I get exactly the value lambda in my measurement. So if lambda is in a continuous spectrum of my operator, then this E of this point lambda is equal to 0. So this means this quantity for whatever x I have is a continuous function at this point lambda. So this means there is no way of getting a probability of 1 exactly for this point. So this means the probability of measuring exactly lambda is 0. Yeah, but on the other hand, we know that we have approximate eigenvectors, so I can take small intervals around lambda such that I have elements there. So if I take intervals, so for each interval, of the form lambda plus and minus 0, lambda plus and minus epsilon, where epsilon is bigger than 0. So let me call this interval, let's say, lambda of epsilon. So this is from lambda minus epsilon to lambda plus epsilon for fixed lambda in the continuous spectrum. So then we have that the E, this projection corresponding to this interval here, that this is not equal to 0, because we have approximate eigenvectors. So we have elements which are very close to lambda. So this guy here is not equal to 0, and this means I can take elements in the range of this space, so I can prepare my system in a state such that now if I measure whether I'm not exactly lambda, but I measure whether I'm in this interval, then again I have this with probability 1. So for each epsilon I have a state, so thus we have states, let me call them x epsilon, in my Hilbert space, such that if I prepare my system in this state, so if the system is in this state, then the measurement, such that the measurement in such a case gives, again with probability 1, an outcome. But this outcome is now not exactly lambda, but it's in this interval, delta lambda. So a result in delta epsilon. Huh? Okay, so for each epsilon, I can prepare my system. In principle, there is a state such that if my system is now in this state, then the measurement gives me with probability 1 a value which lies in this interval. Okay, so that's the meaning of the continuous spectrum. The outcome of the measurement will never be exactly this value lambda, but I can prepare my systems in such a way that the outcome will be as close to lambda as I like.